How will soldiers fight with robotic-controlled vehicles? Some Green Berets with the 1st Special Forces Group recently spent 2 weeks in Utah buzzing around the desert with unmanned vehicles to figure that out. The field operation, or robot dune buggy race maybe, is part of an effort called Project Origin. Army Combat Capabilities Development Command engineers at the Ground Vehicle Systems Center worked alongside these bearded bad boys to collect data on this emerging technology. The soldiers learned basic vehicle handling and ran standard mission training packages, including multiple day and night live fires. Those live fires included an M240 machine gun, the MODEUCE 50 cal, and my personal favorite, the Mark 19 grenade launcher. The Green Berets worked both offensive and defensive maneuvers, so think about like convoy operations, patrols, and ambushes. They also had to run long-range reconnaissance movements and practice concealment with unmanned vehicles. Electronic warfare and autonomous resupply missions were also on the menu for those operators. The soldiers were fitting unmanned vehicles with soldier-driven vehicles and dismounted troops. The ultimate goal is to have robot vehicles run as a kind of a reliable battle buddy in combat. So data scientists gather information from this soldier experiment for the Army's Robotic Technology Kernel, or RTK. The RTK information feeds into a library of software that can eventually be pulled from to teach robotic vehicles how to operate with humans near instantaneously, rather than having to redrive, retrain these future systems on how to maneuver. All that data comes through to the soldier in the warfighter machine interface, the Army's library of software being used to control robotic vehicles. But you don't have to be special forces to play with robot vehicles. Regular old soldiers and Marines have been part of the Army's Small Multipurpose Equipment Transport, or SMET, program. That's a kind of a robotic mule that basically runs autonomously alongside dismounted troops, but also can be operated by a driver. The SMETs carry gear and supplies, food, water, ammo, and medicine, to take that load off the dismounted soldier. Back in October, the Army put Project Origin vehicles in the rotation at the Joint Readiness Training Center at Fort Polk, Louisiana. That exercise took two of the vehicles and paired them with soldiers from the 1st Battalion, 509th Infantry, and the 3rd of the 101st Airborne Division in a simulated battle with each other. And wouldn't you know it, a tropical storm pounded the soldiers in the midst of the exercise. But hey, if it ain't raining, you ain't, well, nah, never mind, I'm not gonna say that, it's just old school. Soldiers at JRTC used their robot to block an intersection for 36 hours. The vehicle's low heat signature and battery-powered silent watch system helped out quite a bit. The 509th soldiers also used the robot to block helicopter landing zones and run route reconnaissance, taking another type of load off of the soaking wet soldiers. Or as one expert said, if we assign them the dumb, dirty, dangerous missions to our robots, we can reassign our soldiers to the high-priority complex missions and tasks that they really need to do in the field. Or maybe they can just take a nap? I don't know, just a suggestion. Now back in 2022 in Utah with the Green Berets. Those Green Berets said that a key feature of using the unmanned vehicles allowed for a better standoff, which really gives them a better chance to recognize and identify individuals, targets, or threats from a distance, and that also decreases the risk to the soldier. One senior weapons sergeant said that it allows troops to focus on terrain analysis and think ahead instead of running up on an enemy and having to seek cover or return fire immediately. I think I agree. I'd rather send a robot out to check out a target than show up for a lead-filled greeting. We'll keep track of all your military robot needs here at Military Times. This has been Todd South.